M3. Queues are back to Junction 2 at Greencastle at the moment. It's not looking much better on the M1. Long queues remaining from just after Junction 6 at Saintfield Road through to Junction 1 at Broadway. That's after an earlier crash was cleared. Those queues then continue from Broadway on the West Link through to the M2 and the M3. We've also got delays on the A2 Shore Road from Jordanstown towards the start of the M5 and on the Malone, Ormo and Lisburn Roads in Belfast heading towards the city centre. And one flight to mention at Belfast International Airport, EasyJet's 5:10 arrival from Gatwick has been delayed until 11:30. Elaine Sutherland reporting from the Traffic Control Centre.
Travel news on BBC Radio Ulster.
The biggest show in the country starts now.
The stories of abuse at St Colman's College Newry continue. Sinn Féin's Conor Murphy has revealed that he was physically abused and sexually groomed by the paedophile priest, Father Malachy Finnegan. We continue asking the same question. Who knew what? And when did they know? Also in Nolan today, Middlesex Council has voted to bring in bonfire licences. Could they be brought in across Northern Ireland? And the unbelievable story of a seemingly ordinary punter who gambled €9 million but lost 10, so robbed his post office to make up the difference. Here's the number today, 03030 80 55 55.
On Twitter at Stephen Nolan and on Facebook at Real Stephen Nolan.
Good morning. Sinn Féin MLA Conor Murphy has spoken out about his time at St Colman's College Newry and said the paedophile priest, Father Malachy Finnegan, physically abused him and tried to sexually groom him. In an interview with the Press Association, Mr Murphy described the priest as violent, volatile, bullying, drunkard, and recounted an incident from when he was a 14-year-old pupil at the school. You may find some of this disturbing. You may also want to contact us if you were a pupil at that school. Here's the number, 03030 80 55 55. Conor Murphy has been speaking to David Young from the Press Association.
Well, I went to the college in 1975 at the age of 11, 12, I think it was when it started. I was there for 5 years. Malachy Finnegan took over in January 76, so he was principal from all but 6 months of my time there. He was deeply unpopular, even as a first year, and when we were only 12-year-old, we were in the school. As a first year, we were aware that he was deeply unpopular among the students. He wasn't liked. And as time went on, you probably have more of a sense of the why of that. I mean, he was very violent, volatile. He was prone, I mean, beaten and, I suppose, controlled. And violence in that school was a matter of life in the school, because pupils were routinely beaten as part of disciplinary measures. But his was a different, his was a violent attack. He would assault people. He also was, it was evident to me that he was drinking very heavily. I mean, I was only a kid, but I worked in a bar from when I was 12-year-old, and I knew he would appear in the corridor in the mornings with the shoelaces undone, his vest hanging out underneath his shirt, the eyes bloodshot, and you know, quite aggressive, and you know, probably in launching an attack, and if somebody was coming up the corridor with their tie knot straight, they were liable to get thumped in the face for it. So, I mean, that was going on. That was a matter of course throughout my time there. And we also, I suppose, as time went on, people then, the students themselves, got to know that he had an unhealthy interest in young boys, and that if you were in the room alone with him, you know, that he was liable to ask you very inappropriate questions and display an inordinate interest in your sexual development as a child. So, I mean, we were all kind of, that was kind of common currency among kids, and we were, at that stage, we were only 13, 14-year-old. We knew that. We didn't know at that stage. I didn't know what a paedophile was. We didn't know the behaviour of a paedophile, but as an adult looking back, it was fairly obvious to us that these were the the classic symptoms of paedophilia. So when the story broke around Margie Flanagan and abusing people, then it didn't come as any surprise to most of the people that I've spoken to at all.
And in terms of your own experience and encounters with Flanagan, can you relay some of those?
Well, when I was about, I think it was just before the end of our third year, I was a 14-year-old. There was a bit of a ruckus going on in the class that we were in, and Flanagan burst into the room. He singled me out. He dragged me out by the hair, sort of the hair in the crown of your head, dragged me along the corridor, up two flights of stairs into his room. Then he beat me with a stick on the hands and then about the body, because, as I say, he was always prone to more violence than perhaps was to do with discipline. And then he suddenly flipped, as I almost was expecting. He sat me down then and started to ask me personal questions. Did I smoke? Did I drink? Did I go out? Bear in mind, I was 14-year-old. Did I go out with girls? Did I masturbate? Did I love him? This type of conversation. So, I mean, I can't remember my responses, but I wasn't shocked by the conversation, because I'd been forewarned by other pupils that this is what was likely to happen. And when I left, got up to leave it, he told me to leave the school to get out. It was about 2 weeks left at the end of term, and he told me not to come back after the next, for fourth year. So, like most, I suppose, young people then, I was too afraid to tell my parents. I'd been expelled from school, and I did go back in fourth year, and I avoided him for several months, you know, on the corridors. He eventually stopped me and challenged me about being in the school. But he let it sit then, and I went on through the rest of fourth year and fifth year. I got enough O-levels to qualify me for going to do A-levels in the school. But at the end of fifth year, in the summertime, he wrote a letter home to my parents telling me not to come back to the school. So I was relieved, to be quite honest with you, as were most people that I knew who left the school around that period, relieved to get out of it.
And did he give a reason why he wanted you to leave the school? I mean, was there friction between you going forward from that?
No, I hadn't many dealings with him after that. I can't recall the exact text of the letter, but it was that there was no specific allegation. It just said I wasn't suitable material for the school.
And your experience in that office, were you aware, or did you have knowledge of that at that young age, that what he was trying to do in terms of ask you sexual questions? What is it
well,
that it was?
We were aware that it was wrong, it was inappropriate, it was not natural for a man, particularly a priest, to behave in that fashion. But I suppose at that age, this is the late 70s, we were 14-year-old, we didn't understand paedophilia. We didn't understand it was essentially a grooming exercise. But we knew that quite a few pupils had gone through it. We didn't know at that time, and it would be wrong to say otherwise, we didn't know that he had sexually abused boys. But we knew and understood that he had an unhealthy interest. And that if the way to approach that conversation was to kind of shut down and try and get out of his office as quickly as you could.
It's been described by many recounting their stories that this was an open secret within the school. Was that how you would?
Yes, absolutely. And you mean the pupils had forewarned each other. So, I mean, looking back on it now as an adult, you know, you have to wonder if as children, which we were, at 13, 12, 13, 14 year old, we knew that he was a violent bully. He was abusing alcohol, or he certainly was drunk or suffering the ill effects of drink many, many mornings that we arrived at the school. And he had an unhealthy interest in young boys. So we knew as children that he was not fit to be a teacher. He wasn't certainly not fit to be a principal. And then you have to ask yourself, what did other staff in the school think of him? What did the boards of governors think of him? What did the education authorities think? Who was responsible for inspecting the school? Who was responsible for the welfare of children that were going through that school? Because they effectively left him in place for almost a decade as a principal, more than that, as a teacher, and they left him to abuse people, without any interference, probably across two generations of boys.
And what's your explanation for why that wasn't allowed to happen?
Well, I think that's what needs to be investigated. I mean, part of my rationale, I mean, I knew my story, and obviously other people knew my story going forward. It wasn't, and I've seen other stories since, so my stories, isn't different to others. I was reluctant to talk about it, not because of any personal reservation, but because I knew then when the case emerged about people who were sexually assaulted by him and others, I felt it's much more important for those people to tell their story. My story pales into insignificance in relation to that. But I did feel a responsibility as a former pupil, but also as a public representative, to ensure that I supported what they were trying to do and bring that forward. So I did make my testimony available to the legal representatives of the people who are taking cases. And then following discussion, I decided then that it was important for myself as a public representative to go forward and say, this is what was happening in the school at that time. I believe those people when they say they were sexually abused. I hope if others were sexually abused that they do come forward with their story. I hope me speaking publicly maybe gives some people some confidence to come forward. And that's the purpose of me speaking. It's not to draw any degree of sympathy for myself, but it's actually, I think, encourage others to say that we believe those who say they were sexually abused. We know the pattern in the school. Anyone that I have spoken to, and I've spoken to lots of former pupils over the last number of weeks in the Newry area, all recount similar stories, all recount a knowledge that we knew that was going on in the school at the time. And so it's just to validate those people who are now coming forward with horror stories, both in the school and people who endured abuse from him in his parish duties as well. But it's also to say, as I say, this wasn't just confined to a church thing. This was an education establishment. This was an institution, a school, which was full of lay people, full of other priests, governed by boards of governors, subject to investigation and support and by education authorities, by CCMS. And where were all those people during this period? They allowed us as children to suffer all of that.
And you recalled your own personal experience, but yeah, did you witness other incidents, a lot of other incidents?
I witnessed them attacking people in the corridors, clips and punches or whatever. Most of the more sinister stuff was in the privacy of his own room. Mm-hmm. Other people told me their stories at the time. That's why I was kind of prepared for what was to come in his room. But other people that I didn't realise, close friends, went through a similar experience. And it's only since this has broken that people have said, This is what happened to me. So I think the experience that I had certainly was replicated by many, many, many pupils in that school. Obviously, the instances of actual sexual abuse was felt by a significant number of people. And I think that what we need to do is to validate what those people are saying, to tell them that we believe them, to say that there is a police ombudsman investigation here, it needs to run its course. There's a police investigation as to whether the school authorities, including the church, told the police in time. But there's a wider issue here of this wasn't confined to church. This was a responsibility for pupils in that school that went well beyond the Catholic Church, that went into the systems of government here, went into education authorities and boards, and boards of governors. And I think that's what merits a fuller investigation, is to say, if we could understand to a certain level within our own childish experience and within our own, I mean, the knowledge of paedophilia in the late 70s, particularly among young people, isn't what it is today. But if we, at that stage, as children, understood to a certain extent what was going on, what did adults understand that was going on?
If you look back, given that context, with anger as to what was allowed to happen?
I don't have any feelings for any of the individuals, including Finnegan, one way or another. He's dead, he's gone. I'm angry that as the stories have emerged of the number of people who were abused and the fact that it was common knowledge, as I said, not here saying in the late 1970s we knew that he was sexually abused people, we didn't. And maybe some people did in the school, but I didn't, as a child in school, didn't know that. But I'm angry that a man who was violent, aggressive, bully, drunkard, with an unhealthy interest in children, and that was obvious, was allowed to be a principal of a school, was allowed to be a teacher in school over a long number of years, allowed access to young boys. And bear in mind, there were a lot of boys boarded in that school as well. It wasn't just the day pupils. He had opportunity and access to people in the evenings that stayed and lived in the school.
Why do you think it has taken so long for all this to come to the public domain?
I suppose it has taken the courage of some of those who were sexually abused to come forward and say and make their case. And that's a very difficult thing to do. As I say, I don't consider myself, my experience pales into insignificance in comparison to that. It should never have happened to a child. in any school, in any setting, at any era. But I think what has taken time, I suppose, is that people who have real stories and real pain and real issues to deal with and real questions to be answered and a case to be made have started to come forward. And I think it's important, as not just a former pupil, as I say, but as a public representative, that I go out and say publicly, and I've taken advice on this, that I go and say publicly that I believe them and everybody that I've spoken to believes them, and that they should come forward and tell their stories and make their case and make sure that the people who are in authority have questions, that have questions to answer, do are forced to answer those questions.
Maybe finally then, Conor, what would your message be to people who still feel reluctant, maybe a sense of shame or embarrassment even? Yeah. To come forward with their stories and would rather just keep them to themselves? I mean, what would your message
be? Well, I mean, I completely understand that, because that's what abuse does to people. It makes them feel a part of it in some way, you know, and clearly I heard the testimony of some of the people that they were made to feel, as children, a sense of responsibility for what was happening to them, and it was obviously completely false. So I will understand if people have moved on with their lives and feel that they're dealing with these things and have no wish to open up that experience again, you know, because most of the people are in and around my age now, maybe older, some younger. I can understand that, but what I would say is, you know, if people feel that they can come forward, they should do. You know, there was a system of administration in that school for a long number of years which allowed a paedophile to flourish, give them authority. Give them authority not only over all of the pupils, but give them authority over all of the staff as well, and put him in a position where he could abuse people. And that needs to be explored, it needs to be investigated, it needs to be inquired into, and answers are needed. I mean, was there complaints even anonymously made to education authorities over that period of time? Did nobody put their hand up and say, this man should not be running a school, never mind teaching pupils? Did anyone ask a question about him? Did anyone raise any issue? And if not, why not? Was the system so that people couldn't, even adults who worked at the school, adults that were on the boards of governors, adults who were part of inspection regimes that must have come into the school at various times, was no one able to put their hand up and say, there's something wrong here? We all knew it. We were children.
You are elected representative, obviously, in the area. Describe to me today, what is the feeling? What is the reaction? What do people think about this story? And you know, are they angry? Are they angry at the school? Are they angry at the Catholic Church? What is the sense of the
I think there's a general sense of anger to all of that. And a lot of people are asking the same questions that I'm asking. You know, I mean, I've had people from other schools say to me, we all knew what was going on in the college. You know, I mean, there's four grammar schools in Newry and two secondary schools, three secondary schools, including Newry High. And people say, it was common knowledge among us as kids that Father Finnegan was unhealthy interest, that he was violent, that he was there was something going on there with the boys in the college, that it was common knowledge among school kids. So I think there's a general sense of anger that people who have a responsibility for the welfare of children clearly let them down. And I think people do believe, I've had nobody that has spoken to me, particularly former pupils, has disputed any of the testimony that has been brought forward by people who are abused and said that couldn't have happened or it didn't happen. People believe that it did happen. And the questions they ask is, how did all the people who were responsible for the welfare and safety of children in that school, both working in that environment, involved in the education authorities, involved in the church, involved in the board of governors, how did all the people not step in and say there's something wrong here?
Well, that's Conor Murphy speaking to David Young from the Press Association. And Conor is on the money, isn't he? Big time. It's a question that this programme has been posing for well over a week now, which is, who else knew about the abuse within that school? Are we really suggesting that this widespread physical and sexual abuse within St Coleman's College, Newry, went unnoticed by anybody else? Martin O'Brien with us this morning. Martin, good morning to you.
Good morning, Stephen.
Good morning. You said on the television show last Wednesday night, there's more to come. And from what we can see coming into the Nolan Show, leads and information and people contacting us, there's a lot more to come, Martin.
Yes, there is. And I think we just have to stand back here for a minute, Stephen. It's now 6 weeks or so since the Spotlight programme and Mandy McCauley brought all this into the public domain for the first time. And you know what? If we had an assembly functioning, if we had an executive functioning, there would have been an emergency debate in the assembly by now. The Minister for Education would be forced to answer questions about what is going on and what has been going on. Now, I think too...
But Martin, we do have the senior administration within the Catholic Church in place right now, who say that they're cooperating fully with the PSNI investigation regarding historical abuse. They say this is the most suitable mechanism to address these issues. Until investigations are complete, the board will not be making further public statements. Right? So that's from St. Coleman's. Do they not think they need to give the public any reassurance as to...
Absolutely. Absolutely. Such is the public concern around this. There has to be a proper independent inquiry into this. I have been a school governor. I've been a governor of a university, a member of the Senate of Queen's University. If I was a member of the Board of Governors of St. Coleman's, I would be asking, look, okay, this happened historically, but what assurance can we have that this will never happen again? I thought it was very significant there that Conor Murphy mentioned the Council for Catholic Maintained Schools. And in a way, he has stolen my thunder, because I was planning to make reference to them in a column in the Irish News next week. The Council for Catholic Maintained Schools has management oversight of St. Coleman's and other Catholic schools. I would have thought that by now they should be consulting appropriately and about terms of reference for an independent inquiry. Maybe that inquiry could be conducted by a QC or by a retired judge. You know, the point is this: there is now a steady stream of new information coming forward. You had the call by Clem Lenehan, brother of Mary McAleese, for an independent inquiry. The NIO brushed that aside and said, oh, this is a matter for a devolved executive. Well, it looks as if we'll not have a devolved executive for any time soon. So therefore, it's incumbent that alongside the police investigation, that that there is a proper independent inquiry as well. So all that is in play. And yes, I'm afraid I have been told that this could get much bigger. Indeed, somebody who is fairly close to the situation told me that there are fears that this could become as big as the Brendan Smith scandal.
Well, we are currently pursuing a number of lines of investigation, Martin, and you'll understand that we need to let that journalistic process run its course. But I can say this at this stage. We are being contacted by victims where there will be new stories about different people. And it is incredible that the physical abuse alone, let's talk about the sexual abuse in a moment. The physical, the vile, well beyond any type of acceptable to anybody corporal punishment that went on within that school. It was not corporal punishment. It was physical assault. I can state that as a matter of fact. When children are being punched, when children are being knocked unconscious, when children were being dragged out of a classroom by the hair. You heard Conor Murphy this morning,
yes. Well,
beaten with sticks. How did that go on within that school in plain sight? Why did no other adult say, stop?
Correct. I was speaking to somebody yesterday who's close to the situation, and he's a former pupil, a pupil of Finnegan, a person actually who said to me that in his first year in Finnegan, in his first year in the school, Finnegan once put his arm around him and made to put his hand down the back of his trousers. And he said that he told him, don't do that again. He stood up to him. Incredible courage for that particular person. But what it seems, Stephen, that whilst excessive corporal punishment was part and parcel of the, and was endemic to the culture of diocesan schools, but schools generally in Northern Ireland. What now seems to be coming apparent, but obviously this will have to be tested in an inquiry, that there seems to be in St. Coleman's perhaps a conflation between the corporal punishment, the massively excessive corporal punishment administered by Finnegan, and the sexual abuse. And I know that you allude to that in your programme this day week. But all this now really has to be investigated.
You see,
and there's a pattern here. Just to bring up something separately, but in brackets, I talk about the Assembly and about no functioning Assembly, no functioning executive. Take the Judge O'Hara inquiry into the five deaths of the children in the hospital. That would be the subject of an emergency debate long by now in the Assembly. So all this underlines the fact that really, just because we're in a political limbo situation here, that such an unfolding scandal has to be addressed, and addressed credibly.
There is one story within St. Coleman's of what went on. I'm saying it again. The other story is, how did no other adult intervene? Who knew what and when? What was their responsibility as an adult within that school to protect other children?
Yes.
And they were seeing it. Some of these adults were seeing physical abuse of children. How could they not? Some of these adults were witnessing. Remember what happened within St. Coleman's. There was a study hall when Finnegan would come in and pick out a child, and that child was being picked out to be physically abused. Some of these children were being beaten up in front of others. We got to start identifying who those people were.
But I have to say, alongside that, another sexual a victim of sexual assault by Finnegan has told me that a section of the boys certainly knew. Suspected about the sexual abuse. Everybody knew about the corporal abuse.
Yeah.
As regards the sexual abuse was concerned, boys would be afraid to report that to the teacher or to a priest for the fear, the terrible fear that they were gay. But as far as the corporal, the assaults are concerned, yes, I'm afraid I had it from a former pupil who said to me yesterday there was a culture in the school, among the teachers, and that of course would have included the priest, of turning a blind eye to those assaults, and certainly that would form a very big part of any inquiry.
Martin O'Brien, thank you very much indeed. We'll pause there. We'll get the news at 9:31.
Now, the news from the BBC. The Stephen Nolan
Show. Hello, Stephen. As we've been hearing, the Sinn Féin MLA Conor Murphy says a paedophile priest physically abused him when he was a schoolboy in County Down. The Newry and Armagh representative was a pupil at St. Coleman's College in Newry in the 1970s when the late Father Malachy Finnegan was a teacher there. In an interview with the Press Association, Mr. Murphy said the priest dragged him into an office and savagely beat him with a stick before asking him a number of sexually explicit questions. Mid-Ulster Council has voted in favour of introducing a licensing system for bonfires. And the Taoiseach says Ireland could expel Russian officials if they are shown to be acting as intelligence agents. Leo Varadkar was speaking after the European leaders agreed it was highly likely Russia was responsible for a nerve agent attack in the UK. That's all for the moment. More from me at 10.
Right, Jim Gamble with us this morning. Anne-Marie, thank you. Former head of the Child Exploitation Online Protection Centre. Good morning to you, Jim.
Morning, Steve.
Good morning, Jim. Obviously, at St. Coleman's, there were many decent teachers, okay? Look, that's a given. And there were teachers who were doing what we all expect them to do, which is teach children, look after children, protect them. But Jim, there has got to have been at least a moral, if not legal, responsibility if any other teacher or any other adult saw these children being beaten up in plain sight that they had the report that, even if it was back in the 80s and 90s, and Jim?
Well, I think that's absolutely right. What we need to do now is to differentiate between that, which needs to be dealt with as a contemporary criminal issue, and that which is about telling the truth so that we can learn lessons from this and ensure that it doesn't happen again. Because in one way, it's difficult for the contemporary St. Colman's, which I'm sure is complying with all of today's insights into safeguarding and policies and practices around that, because they're having to live in this shadow. And I think for them, it would be a cathartic release that to manage this in a slightly different way. But I'm sure they're limited by the ongoing criminal investigation. But yes, does there need to be some kind of review that allows people to come forward and talk? Yes, of course there does.
And Jim, in terms of the sexual abuse of these children within the school, how does a paedophile do that, Jim, within a school on multiple occasions to multiple different pupils, and that not be stopped pretty quickly?
What paedophiles who are prolific do in this type of situation is two things. They condition and control people around them. So they'll condition one group of people to admire them and think so well of them. And generally they do that to the people above them, to those people who could, in fact, interdict the behaviour, those people who might, you know, have authority over them. They will create and ingratiate themselves with them in a way that they would think, well, these things are said. And isn't it awful that people would suggest such horrible rumours, because we know, you know, that this particular man is a man of God and he's doing the best he can for children in difficult circumstances. So they upwardly groom them and condition them to think they're very good. The control is the other issue. And that's why you see with so much child abuse, it's more about the power and control. And you see that in the outward acts of straightforward physical violence. And the sexual abuse is part of that violence and power. So what they do is they create a sense of fear amongst others that they wouldn't dare challenge them. One, because the people at the top wouldn't believe them. And two, because of the consequence, either that person would retaliate in a brutal way or that they would be isolated, unbelieved and humiliated. And that's what they do. And whether it's in this case or the recent case of Martin Goldberg, you know, a deputy headmaster in England. And I think we need to begin stepping back and not just concentrating on St. Colman's. This is a prolific issue. It's one whereby when we have an opportunity like this to learn lessons, we must do it. But we need to do it in a balanced way. And what we wouldn't want is to make people who perhaps did suspect and didn't come forward think that if they do come forward now and share that learning, they'll be demonised, if not criminalised.
Jim, when you said this needs to go beyond St. Colman's, and I said this the other day, I am both gobsmacked and confused as to the volume of allegations of sexual abuse that the Nolan Show is receiving across Northern Ireland. It is incredible when we look at our files about what's coming into us. Multiple victims, multiple locations, allegations around it, people speaking for the first time, and they've been holding on to this abuse for 20, 30 years.
I mean, that again shouldn't surprise us. This is about lancing a boil. And what happens is many people keep the secret because of shame. They've been conditioned to feel that shame themselves. And what happens is when people begin coming out and talking about it, when they see that they're being treated as credible, and that they're being supported, that encourages. Some people won't have told, perhaps because they didn't want to hurt their parents or to have them, you know, feel that they were somehow in the wrong for allowing this to happen. And very often you see survivors of abuse come forward after their parents have died, or even when they become parents themselves and the whole weight and responsibility of parenthood. There'll be different times. So I think Connor coming out, for example, and talking about the physical abuse there is a good thing. People in leadership roles beginning to talk about it, and that should encourage others. But we shouldn't be surprised when the floodgates open. If you look at Operation Yew Tree in the aftermath of the Jimmy Savile investigation, the minute I think people saw they were being treated with respect, being treated credibly, that at last they could tell their story. Part of the healing process begins because telling that story is really important, that being listened to is really important. And in my experience, most of these aren't vengeful stories. These are cathartic releases of a legacy of pain that people have carried with them for decades.
Do you think a public inquiry is necessary?
Yes, I do. I think, look, we've gone through the Hart inquiry. We've looked at institutional abuse in that respect. We need to give people an outlet. Otherwise, it becomes chaotic. And then within the chaos, you miss important messages. You miss important lessons. So constructing some mechanism whereby this can be dealt with, where people can come forward, I think is really important. And when we look back in the 70s and the 80s and before and of course beyond, there was a time when people viewed things differently. They were conditioned to think, well, of course, corporal punishment is okay, and that is a difficult or that is a promiscuous child. The blame, it was a lot of victim blaming. We now are much better educated. We have a much better understanding. So now is the time to put the past right. We're never going to fix it for the people who've been hurt and abused, but what we can do is help them on their journey to a better place.
Here's a question for the PSNI this morning. And look, we haven't put this to them, so it's an open question. It's clear from the contacts that we have, Jim, that they are setting up an investigation unit into sexual abuse, clerical sexual abuse. We know that, okay? Why are they not setting up a separate unit into physical abuse of children in Northern Ireland? You know, abuse that could not be defined as being within the parameters of corporal punishment, which was legal at the time. I'm talking about the serious assault, physical assault of children, which is a criminal offence. Kids being knocked unconscious, etc. Should there not be a different investigation into that?
Well, I think you've got to look at child abuse on the whole. So neglect, physical, sexual and emotional abuse all amount to forms of child abuse. And each one of those, I mean, we've seen so much about coercive control and emotional abuse coming to the fore. We know how that influences life choices and opportunities. So, of course, I would expect a sophisticated approach from the PSNI in this regard. And I'm hopeful, and I'll tell you why. If you look at the recent update report from Her Majesty's Inspector about the Met, they are still struggling. They are still having difficulty supporting local authorities around child abuse and safeguarding investigations. You know, the flip side of that is the PSNI have looked at their public protection unit. They have reinforced it. I think within our geography, they're doing the best they can. So I would hope that they're listening to this and they are considering and reflecting. Actually, when we have this type of investigation, we need to look at all forms of criminal abuse that children suffered. And if those people are still alive, well, the strong message is that if we didn't catch you then, we'll catch you now. That's the deterrent for what people might do in the future. And I think a criminal investigation can survive in a healthy way alongside a proper public review, because the review should have mechanisms whereby if something of a criminal nature is disclosed, that is immediately passed to the police. And one of the benefits of that is that actually the police have the encouragement or the watching eye or the prompt from an organisation outside carrying out that review who are going to follow through to the end to see what comes of that particular case.
OK, Jim Gamble, thank you very much. Fran, North Belfast. Morning, Fran.
Morning, Stephen. Stephen, the first thing I'd like to say this morning is I totally agree with everything I've heard to this point on the show. I feel that paedophilia and acts of abuse against children and others in society goes far, far, far beyond the Catholic Church, the clerical abuse and the legal requirements and moral obligations of individuals and the schools involved that maybe to have done more. I'd like to echo some of the things that I've heard. One of them being very much so that the public representatives who may, you know, have first-hand experience of this type of thing should come out in order to create a safer environment, the same way that your show has, the Nolan Show, to encourage people to come forward to get as much information to the police and the statutory services as possible. I also believe that these things are all thriving in silence, and there's a complicity in wider society from the people who are carrying out these acts or, you know, aided or other people are complicit in their silence when allegations are brought forward. So just the two things I really want to concentrate are on the justice for the victims should be evidence-led through the police, followed by prosecutions of anyone who's found guilty of paedophilia who's still alive. Those people should face the full rigours of the law. But to echo everything that everybody else is saying, to stop this going forward, it's very, very, very important to get the people who, again, evidence led, if people went to someone, explained what was happening, made allegations.
It's bigger than that, though, Fran. Sorry that I'm getting frustrated this morning. I guess my frustration is that I'm seeing the files. Yes. I'm seeing the information within the files, all right? Other people knew about this.
Yes.
It's impossible that other people could not have known. So even think about what Conor Murphy said this morning. He was dragged by the hair up three flights of stairs in open sight and then beaten with a stick. Now, that's child abuse.
Absolutely.
And I'm hearing from lots of adults saying, oh, well, that's what happened at the time. And I even saw someone incredibly respectable writing the other day, oh, does Nolan not realise that corporal punishment happened within schools everywhere? That's not corporal punishment. That is sadistic abuse of a child. Michael Newton Abbey. Morning, Michael.
Good morning, Stephen. Stephen, paying very particular attention. There's something that's missing in this. If I went to school, and when I went to school and was corporal punishment, but if it was excessive or whatever, when I went home to my parents, I remember on two occasions my parents went up to the school to deal with this. And the reason I'm saying this is, this seems to be something that was going on perhaps on a daily basis. And parents speak to each other outside the school or at weekends and so on. There seems to be an absence of parental influence or parental input in all of this disclosure. And I think that's scary. Now, perhaps this is because of the fear that the Catholic Church had at that time.
Remember also the respect for the Catholic Church at that time, and parents sometimes believing a priest before they would believe their own children.
But if you see your child coming home with marks on them and severely stressed and crying, I mean, surely that, I mean, it's one thing to have, you know, respect for the church. It's another thing to have greater respect for your child.
Some of these children were boarders, don't forget. Some of them were boarders.
Stephen, so some of them, yes, but we're talking about others. I mean, we're talking about in the generality of what we're talking about. Only some of them are boarders. There was bound to be a vast majority of them were not boarders, and they were coming home, and they were talking, or maybe they weren't talking. Perhaps you're right. They were concealing it. And the other thing that
Michael, you know, I spoke to a man, it was two days ago, who he had been beaten so badly on a regular basis by a priest that when it came to happen on the next occasion, he jumped out the window of the first floor building. He jumped out the window of the school as a child to get away from it.
Was he a boarder, or did he have parents, or was there guardians, someone he could speak to?
I'd need to check the details. But he jumped out the window.
Because I think, for me, I find it so appalling, to be quite honest with you. It's disturbing, it's distressing to know that someone's child is coming home, telling them about brutality, and their parents having so much, and you use the word respect, but it's also fear, Stephen, as well.
Yeah.
That they're going to say, no, the father so-and-so wouldn't do this, and that's a terrible thing to say. And especially if this is an ongoing thing and it's happening with so many people, I find that absolutely appalling and distressing that a church or that an organisation, a school, you know, could ignore, and basically that's what they were doing. They were ignoring it. And I find that absolutely distressing. You know, it's so sad that an organisation, and yes, corporal punishment on, and whether we accept it within certain bounds is actually irrelevant. It's when it's excessive and you're going home and you're telling your parents this and your parents are not doing anything about it. I find that incredible, whether it's 2016 or 19...
Okay.
97.
Michael,
doesn't matter, Steve.
All I can do is assure people this morning, you know, we are working around the clock on information that's coming into the Nolan Show. That's all I can say at this stage. And let me tell you, if we can get some stories out there about some of the stuff that we are seeing, this country will be shocked. even
further. Could I make one more point, please, just very quickly?
Very quickly.
I listened to what Connor was saying, and Connor saying that he's coming out now as a representative. Connor was a representative many, many years ago, and he could have come out. Why did he wait
Michael. I think I'll tell you why I think that's out of order. Connor's a victim. And it's not for you or this program or anyone else to judge when a victim decides that they are ready to come forward. And I just think I need to draw the line on that. Michael, thank you. Here's some helpline numbers if you feel that you need them. Towards Healing, it's a helpline for survivors of clerical sexual abuse. 0800 096 3315. There is a 24-hour domestic and sexual violence helpline. 0800 917 1414. Nexus on 90 Belfast number 02890 326803. And if you want to contact us as a programme, nolan@bbc.co.uk is our email address. That's where we're currently receiving information. nolan@bbc.co.uk. Now, at 12 minutes to 10, a row has erupted over a licensing scheme for bonfires in Mid-Ulster. Last night, the council there voted through a new policy, which means bonfire builders will have to get a permit to build a bonfire on council land. Organisers will have to ensure that no hazardous or toxic materials are collected, stored or burned, and that no flags, emblems or effigies are burnt on the bonfire. The move, backed by Sinn Féin and the SDLP, brought a furious reaction from unionists. The Ulster Unionist Party has accused Sinn Féin of riding roughshod over the views of unionists. The Ulster Unionist Party councillor Walter Cuddy is with us today. Good morning to you, Walter.
Good morning, Stephen.
Good morning, and the SDLP Councillor Christine Flynn. Good morning, Christine.
Good morning, Stephen.
Good morning. So why would you be furious, Walter, about control around hazardous material?
Well, the bonfire issue has been an issue with us in Dungannon for quite a few years. The new council, we have only really one site, one of several bonfires in Dungannon, but one site on council ground. The Sinn Féin took an issue of it early on, before the 12th last year, and because of that, it doubled in size. And what I felt and my party felt was that, look, we'll get involved with the working groups and see if we can defuse this situation, because Killymurran, which is the bonfire site again, is it's an annual event. It's by and large, a fun event, nothing too serious.
But you're still not telling me, Walter, why you're against control of hazardous material.
Well, when I was in the working group, we are working towards that. You know yourself, we listen to you every morning about issues in Northern Ireland. This is a cultural thing that needs to be addressed over a period of time. We have worked with on the discussion group or the working group. We have talked to all the stakeholders. We're working towards a better solution. And I think we were making good progress throughout the winter. The problem is that they were coming into the springtime. The senior officers have put forward an option papers and then put it into the council. And then that meant that all the good work...
This is all on. Very well, Walter. Why are you against the control of hazardous material?
But we actually put forward option three, which would be to work with the group to try and reduce and move tires and everything away altogether. But the difference between what was passed last night and what we want is time scale. You have to bring the community with you. If you don't bring the community group with you, you're going to have a battle site down there, and that's nobody wants. And it's going to cost... You're going to ask our council staff to go down in there and try and pick up, because every night there'll be even more, because that's what happened last year. So we are, as you say, we want material poison.
Okay.
All away as soon as possible. It's not going to happen this year.
Christine McFlynn, you expect council staff to go in and enforce this if a licence has not been applied for?
No, I don't expect council staff to go in and enforce it, but I'm sure council will be taking measures to try and get these bonfires under control. Stephen, the issues are here with us is that residents have complained to us in particular areas where outsiders have come in and built bonfires in areas that they're not wanted. And they're built far too high and close to people's homes where houses are being
built. But how is this enforceable?
Well, we're going to try our best to work with communities and get agreement with communities if they will buy into it. that they will build the bonfires in such a manner and far enough from people's houses that they will be in agreement to work through it themselves.
But I guess, Christine, that the licensing is only has only got credibility if there's a sting to it, if there is some type of consequence if you don't apply for it. So who is going to enforce this?
Well, what we're doing, Stephen, is we, as Walter says there, we have been, I've been part of the working group and we have had many frank conversations, and it is a very sensitive issue, and we are hoping that the communities will buy into it and that they will take control of it and kind of agree among themselves that, yes, we don't want to be burning tires and we don't want to be burning toxic materials.
But sorry, if you're agreeing among yourselves, if a community is agreeing among itself, then there's no need for a licence. But with the thinking that's been put behind this licence, and it was backed by your party, then there must be, behind that thinking, criteria for what happens if the licence is not adhered to. So what is the SDLP position in backing this licence? Who goes in and removes the material? Who meets out the punishment?
I'm not entirely sure who will, but I don't think we're putting council staff at risk here by sending them into places where it's contentious.
You're not entirely sure. So the SDLP have backed a scheme where they're not entirely sure how it works.
No, the idea is that communities that want to have a bonfire on council property will apply for them. And
They will apply for a licence.
Yes.
And so if the good people who apply for this licence are looking at another site where someone hasn't applied for a licence, will that bonfire be allowed to stand or will it be removed?
Well, council won't have the authority to remove it as far as I understand.
So what's the point of the licensing scheme then?
There may well be an outside agency will have to be brought in to deal with the situation.
And has that been determined? Is that part of the SDLP thinking?
No, this is a long-term situation. We are actually agreeing towards like a strategy of how we move forward.
But this is not long-term, Christine, because last night you voted for this.
I did vote for it because I welcome the fact, Stephen, that people are entitled to celebrate their culture. But at times, things can get overheated and bonfires are far too large and they have to be reduced in size.
But they're not going to be reduced in size because it's clear this morning the SDLP has no clue as to what's going to happen if the bonfire is built beyond what the licence permits.
Well, we're very hopeful that, as I said earlier, that communities buy into this and that they would work along with the fire and rescue service.
Christine, if the communities bought into this, then there would be no need for a licensing scheme, surely.
Sorry, Nolan, I disagree with you. If it's on council property, council have a duty and responsibility that if anybody on their council grounds, that if there's a health and safety risk, that they have a duty to protect them. They also have to protect the residents that live in that area as well.
Jimmy Bryson, the loyalist, has contacted us this morning. Good morning to you, Mr. Bryson.
Hello, Stephen.
Well, lo and behold, here we have a licensing scheme for hazardous or toxic materials. And you're going to be against that, no doubt.
Well, it hardly comes as a surprise to me, since I've been warning for about 10 years that this is where these statutory-led bonfire schemes were eventually leading to. But framing the conversation in that way, that this is a licence to deal with hazardous material, or let's deal with hate and let's build reconciliation and people celebrate their culture, that is all a fig leaf. Because it already fell apart on your show this morning. The SDLP don't have a clue how it's going to work. What this is...
Well, never you mind about the SDLP having a clue how it's going to work. When there are tars and other hazardous materials on bonfires, are you telling me that should not be controlled?
This is quite simply an opportunity for the nationalist-dominated council to poke unionism in the eye, to use Mid-Ulster Council, where there's a nationalist majority, as a laboratory, to try out and to test out this idea of licensing and permitting. And
why should hazardous material not be controlled, Jimmy?
Well, look, people who have bonfires should try and make them as healthy and as positive as possible.
But they don't. But some of them don't.
Stephen, this situation has been contrived so as we talk about these issues. So as these issues, and we think this is what it's all about. It's about controlling waste. It's about dealing with tires. But it's not. It's not. It's about attacking unionist culture because 10 years ago, it was about getting tires off bonfires. So that was fine. The tires came off the bonfires. And then the next year, it was something else. And then it was something else.
So essentially,
we'll keep continuing.
Yeah, but we can cut to the chase here. You want a free-for-all. So you want, because you are a loyalist and your friends are loyalists, you want people to be able to burn massive fires anywhere they like on public land. No control, no rules of engagement, nothing. The rest of us have to abide by the law, and at bonfire season, you can do whatever the hell you want. That's what you want.
Well, no, what I want is that people to be able to do what their fathers and grandfathers have done for many, many years. And let's be clear about this. This is not a group of honest brokers or independent people who are trying to deal with issues. This is a nationalist-dominated council with a political agenda.
This is a democratic vote within a democratic structure where the council voted through a licensing scheme.
Meanwhile, you
want a free-for-all.
Well, of course, at the same time as that, we have the DUP and Sinn Féin set up the Commission and the Flags, Identity, Culture and Tradition. At the same time as that, which is meant to be done in parallel to that. So now, the unionists on that commission surely have to look at this and say, nationalist-dominated councils are now pushing through licensing schemes. Why should we be sitting around the table engaging in a process?
Do you think loyalists will respect this licensing scheme?
I don't think any self-respecting unionist should give credence to this, because I've always been of the view that once, and I was always of the view in relation to the Plaids Commission, that once you started recognising it, then you give it credence, and therefore you would always be bound by it. So the minute that unionists start recognising this permit scheme, the minute that unionists start engaging with it, then you give it credence, and therefore you're always going to be bound by it. The way to break the back of this scheme is to quite simply ignore it, and for no unionist bonfire.
But it's part of council policy, Jamie. What about respecting the law of the land? Ignore it?
It's not the law of the land. It's a council policy.
Yes. So it's a council policy which has been voted through, which presumably will then be enshrined in legislation.
If you think that any self-respecting unionist is going to plead to a Sinn Féin-dominated council and ask them, please, sir, how can I have my bonfire? You tell me how I can have it. What conditions would you like me to adhere to?
Yeah.
You're absolutely insane. This is not going to
because it's completely sane, isn't it, just to say to people, build that really close to houses, build it as big as you want.
I'm not saying
pump tires onto it so as toxic fumes are being breathed by our children,
have no
control over it. And by the way, let's ask the UVF if it's all right.
Well, nobody ever said that. You've just said that. So
because the UVF are not involved whatsoever in the building of bonfires or the control of them. Sure they're not.
Let's just nail this point. Let's address this point right now. People who may have been members of paramilitary organisations throughout the conflict, where do you think they live? They live in unionist communities. They live in loyalist communities. They live in loyalist communities. So you think it's in C? Are they not allowed to go to a bonfire?
Listen, there's quite a lot of reaction to this. We'll take your calls 0303 80 55 55 after the 10 o'clock news.
On 92 to 95 FM and 1341 medium wave, this is BBC Radio Ulster.
And with the news, I'm Anne-Marie Foster. The Taoiseach Leo Varadkar says the Republic could expel Russian officials if they are found to be acting as intelligence agents. He said there would be a security assessment in the coming days, with a decision as early as next week. Mr. Varadkar was speaking after European leaders agreed it was highly likely Russia was responsible for a nerve agent attack in Salisbury earlier this month.
We agreed as a European Union to express full solidarity with the United Kingdom, to agree with their assessment as to who was behind the Salisbury attack, and also to recall the EU ambassador to Russia to Brussels for consultations. And individual countries will decide in the coming days as to whether they want to take additional actions.
The Prime Minister has called for a new dynamic in talks on Britain's future relations with its continental partners. The leaders of the 27 remaining EU member states are expected to clear the way for talks on future trade and security by endorsing the transition deal. Speaking in Brussels before the meeting, which Mrs. May will leave after they have discussed US tariffs, she said she wanted a change in approach to Brexit.
I'm looking for a new dynamic in the next stage of the negotiations, so that we can ensure that we do develop, that we work together to negotiate and develop that strong future economic and security partnership, which I believe is in the interests of the UK and the European Union.
A health trust has apologised to the family of a deaf man who had to tell him themselves that he was going to die. Thomas Carson, who has since died, was admitted to the Ulster Hospital in late 2016. The South Eastern Health and Social Care Trust has paid £7,000 to the family without admission of liability after they failed to provide a sign language interpreter. Anne McKernan is from the Equality Commission.
Mr Carson was an adult, independent man with his own agency, and he should have been able to expect that a medical consultant could communicate directly with him, and then that the family would be able to digest this information together.
Time for sport now with Padraig Coyle.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. Ireland's cricketers have reached 136 for 4 from 38 overs after winning the toss and choosing to bat against Afghanistan in the ICC World Cup qualifier. William Porterfield went for 20, Andrew Balburnie for 11, Paul Sterling was run out for 55, Niall O'Brien went for 36 runs. An Irish win means a place in the World Cup finals next year. Rory McIlroy plays Brian Harman at the World Golf Championships following a 2-1 win over Johnny Vegas. In the European Under-21 Championship qualifier at Portadown last night, Northern Ireland lost 5-3 to Spain. There's league action tonight, 5 matches in all, with second place Coleraine at home to Carrick. Coverage on Sports Sound on Medium Wave from 7:30. And Eugene Laverty was fastest in second free practice ahead of the Thailand World Superbike round.
And Angie Phillips has the weather.
There'll be showery spells around today following this morning's rain, and some will have potential to be on the heavy side. Possibly a few bright intervals, but generally rather cloudy with highs of 8 or 9 Celsius, but the breeze will ease. Rather cloudy with a few showers this evening, and parts of the southeast may hold on to cloud throughout the night, becoming clearer for most parts though, also cold with a slight frost.
BBC News.
BBC Radio Ulster. Travel News.
A broken down lorry that was blocking one lane off the M2 just after Junction 1 at Fort William has been cleared, but some knock-on delays remain heading towards Nelson Street. We've also got delays on the M1 towards Junction 1 at Broadway and on the West Link in both directions, while at Belfast International Airport, EasyJet's 10:05 arrival from Gatwick has been delayed until 11:30. Elaine Sutherland reporting.
Travel news on BBC Radio Ulster.
Morning, Stephen. It's Linda here, and I know just how much you're missing me this morning doing my trail for On Your Behalf and probably taking up too much of your time, for which I really am very grateful. But I can't be in your studio this morning because I'm in Derry, Londonderry, at the Consumer Council's Have Your Say event in the Guildhall, meeting Derry folk and talking to the Chief Executive, John French, about the findings of the Council's 2018 Insight Survey. And then tomorrow On Your Behalf, we're staying in Derry. We'll be in the Radio Foyle studios here about a new initiative, the Social Supermarket in Strabane. Manager Ursula Gallagher says they want to make the statement that poverty is here and has to be dealt with, and that's why the social supermarket is on the main street of the town. And I'll be finding out how it works and why it may be a food bank, but it's a food bank with a difference. Also on the programme, manager of Derry CAB, Jacqueline Gallagher, with the latest information on the rollout of universal credit in the Northwest. So that's On Your Behalf. Same place on the dial, but coming from the Radio Foyle studios, Saturday morning, tomorrow morning, 9:45 till 10:30.
Okay.
Thanks, Stephen.
So that's Linda McCauley with On Your Behalf. It's 6 minutes now past 10. We're talking about a rival licensing scheme for bonfires in Mid-Ulster. Last night, the council voted through a new policy, which means bonfire builders will have to get a permit to build a bonfire on council land. The move was backed by both Sinn Féin and the SDLP. Clear this morning from our interview with the SDLP councillor Christine McFlynn that the SDLP haven't thought through what happens, literally what happens, if someone builds a bonfire against council policy. Brian in Andersonstown, morning to you, Brian.
Morning, Stephen.
Brian, you heard Jimmy Bryson there before the news saying this is a disgrace, this is a poke in the eye to unionists. He's still with us, actually. What do you think, Brian?
Well, I thought you would have picked up on what Jimmy Bryson said there. He said a nationalist domination council. Then he said a Sinn Féin domination council. You're probably going to say Roman Catholic now next time. Does he know what he's talking about? Also, he mentioned about the culture of lighting bonfires and so forth. He seems to forget that it was houses burned down on the top of the end of the Shaggle Road and the problems in Donegal Road.
Well, let me let Jimmy speak to you.
Let me finish. And the problem that we're lighting fires beside filling stations, if that's a part of the culture, God help the people you represent. Also, a wee quick man, no matter what the council say about the bonfires and regulations and so forth, the last say will be held by the power moldies, and he knows that.
Jimmy?
Nobody's speaking to Eamons.
What is the question?
Question is, get your facts right about the council for starters. Okay, is it nationalist or Sinn Féin, or Roman Catholic domination?
Well, it's nationalist dominated. It's dominated.
Oh, but you said Sinn Féin early on there, you know.
Well, Sinn Féin and the SDLP, so it's a nationalist dominated council. So is that your question?
Now, get on to the fires, the bone fires then. Do you condemn what happened in the Shankill Road when the houses were burned down, Donegal Road, bone fires beside filling stations?
I think that everybody, whenever they're celebrating their culture and having the bonfires, should try and do so in a safe a manner as possible. And absolutely nobody should endanger anybody's property or anybody's home. And I think in that regard, that unionists should absolutely regulate themselves and be sensible in terms of those particular bonfires. But again, this is not what this is all about. This is about another phase of the war on unionist culture. And that's what this is really all about. So
you agree with me that bonfires were stayed homes and filling stations, is that part of the culture?
Well, the issue for you see, Brian, is you don't really care about bonfires beside homes or filling stations. You just see that as an opportunity to make bonfires contentious. So if the bonfire moves...
Well, how do you know that?
He could read mine, Stephen.
Well,
can we come back to the licensing issue? The story this morning is about licensing and the fact that Mid Ulster Council have pushed this through. Now, bonfires will need to get a license. Bram, what?
Stephen, I don't see the bonfire issue. I have no problem with bonfires. I mean, I grew up all my life with bonfires, and our own areas as well, which is very destructive. But I have no problem. It's just the contentious ones that I mentioned.
So let's bring in George this morning as well. Morning, George.
Morning, Stephen. How you doing?
Why not? Look, if this is about responsibility within your own community, if this is not about wreck and ruin and doing whatever you want, then this doesn't stop you building a bonfire, does it? It just puts restrictions around the toxic material not being allowed to go onto them.
Let me start off by saying toxic material, tires and that there, is a no-no. Flags is a no-no. It shouldn't happen.
But it does happen.
Yes, absolutely, on a tiny minority of hundreds of bonfires. So a tiny minority of hundreds and hundreds of bonfires. But let's get what this is all about. This is all about, this is Sinn Féin and Residence Groups Part 2. Now, Brian and yourself and others may try and broad brush stoke over it, but it's not.
Brian broad brush were nothing.
Right. Well, let me tell you what I'm telling you. The only thing that will work, these will not work. Licenses will not work. Because if there's a bonfire being built in council property and 25 or 30 feet away, it's a bit of private land, they'll just move it.
What about Sandy Row? Sandy Row, after what happened in England, the flats there.
Listen, you won't listen here. You jumped out. Listen to me now. Listen to me. It's about self. What will work will be self-regulation and learning by mistakes. You asked Jamie, did he condemn the houses being burnt in the Shankill? I was in the phone, Stephen's show the next morning. Yes. What happened? The bonfire was halved in size and moved. They learned from their mistakes. They are. Everybody knows that housing is different from what it was years ago, and it's not as, you know, it's not as easy just to build bonfires at every corner, which doesn't
self-regulation
happen.
Self-regulation hasn't worked, has
self-regulation
it? If self-regulation worked, then we wouldn't have bonfires right beside houses. We wouldn't have fire engines out in the middle of the night having to douse water on these flames in order to stop people being burnt out of their homes. We would not have the Nolan Show every single year highlighting stacks, piles of tires on bonfires. Self-regulation hasn't worked. And maybe, George, maybe here's the problem. Maybe here's the problem with some unionists. Democracy doesn't cut both ways. Maybe you just don't like nationalists being able to get rights through democracy.
Stephen, with respect, see the license that went through last night and the councillors that you had on this morning? Right, they were talking about respect for other people's property and other people's feelings when the burning of flags. Right, this is Mid-Ulster Council. I agree with them. I fully, wholeheartedly agree with them that a neighbouring country's flag should not be burnt on top of a bonfire.
Can I use...
Let's get the rationale and the thinking of Mid-Ulster Council. They think it's wrong, Brian, with respect.
Hold on. Let's calm this down. 0-30-30-80-55-55. Bartley. Morning, Bartley.
Morning, Stephen. Well, here we go again. Well, Jimmy, I pick up on the point that Jimmy said about the bonfires, about things that weren't allowed to be burnt on, like, i.e. they were taking out the tires, they were taking down. We take what we want off the bonfires, Jimmy, and normal thinking people. The little statues stolen from the Catholic churches, the tricolours, the any sort of effigy of any human being, any photograph of somebody burning, any hit. But why do you not agree to a beacon? So that's the whole point of the bonfire, was beacons. Why do you not agree, have a beacon, have it regulated by the council, and have it done? There's one thing you also said about what your father and your forefathers and all that there. I'm sick to death of hearing what all your forefathers done. See what your forefathers done. It's not happening. It's stopping now, Jimmy. All that days is gone. You have to start coming into the real world.
Do you want to respond to this, Jimmy?
I'm walking around with people's finished.
Look, at the end of the day, Bartley's one of these people that, and there we go, he gives the game away when he says, why do you not have a beacon? So it's essentially, I assume, Bartley is probably from the nationalist community, and they're on telling unionists what type of culture they should have. You'd have a beacon.
Jimmy, I'm not telling you what to have, but what I'm telling you what you don't have.
If you'd let me
you shouldn't be putting on stuff. You're the man. I asked you to make condemn the burning of effigies, photographs of human beings. I'm not saying who they are, but burning statues stolen from Catholic churches, burning flags.
Well, if I remember that particular incident, actually, a loyalist...
The statue wasn't burnt, it was removed before.
It was removed by a loyalist on the Shankill.
But that's what
it was never burnt, actually.
Year on year, there are...
Let's let Jimmy respond to you.
Look, where this essentially ends, these statutory-led regulation schemes, and I argued this for 10 years, I was arguing with people saying, do not engage in these statutory-led schemes, because they will eventually lead to a system like the Pleiades Commission. And here we are, it's being tested in Mid-Ulster. And where it will eventually end is this. You can either have a beacon, you can have no bonfire at all, or if you try and have a traditional bonfire, you'll be criminalised. This is where this is going. There's no doubt about that, but this is where this is going.
But Jimmy, do you not think a beacon's the way forward?
No, I don't. I think traditional bonfires held in a respectful manner, burning wood is the way forward. I think that is the way forward.
With no rules around it. With no licensing, with no rules, with the state unable to say, look, this is what you've got to do. Just a free-for-all.
Let's look at where commissions end for unionism and asking for permits. Let's just take the example of the Tates Commission. And you seriously expect unionism to accede to another system which is going to wedge out more elements of unionist culture. And I go back again to the flag identity, culture and tradition.
Sean Zabella Murphy. Morning, Sean.
Good morning. Can I speak to Jimmy?
Well, you can if you like.
Jimmy, I want to put a sensible approach from a Republican to yourself as a loyalist. You just said there that you've known for 10 years that this was coming down the lane.
Yes.
In those 10 years, have you did anything to bring about a charter of bonfire builders or a consensus, something that may bring things forward rather than have things imposed on you?
Well, I've jumped up and down for 10 years and told anybody that would listen, do not engage in these statutory-led schemes.
That's not what he's saying.
I have also continuously said that self-regulation is the way forward, to do things sensibly, to do things properly. But the core of all this is, if everything was fixed, the contentious issues at the moment, if they were fixed,
let's let Sean speak.
Jimmy, you're looking at self-regulation on a case-to-case basis. Would it not be better if the PUL community or Orange community or whatever it is, whoever it is builds the bonfires, came together and decided, okay, this is our charter for bonfires.
Nobody can impose. You can't have a group of
people. Did you not just say about self-regulation?
Yes.
What I'm proposing.
That is a matter for each individual bonfire.
Jimmy, can you be your ego and let somebody else speak, will you? The thing about it is, you're jumping up and down now about council imposing.
Let him speak.
You're jumping up and down about councils imposing or saying that they're going to impose. Would it not have been better for your community to take control of it before it got this far? You've had over 300 years of building bonfires. You know, at this stage, you should be able to get it right. You should, you know, you should be taking into account that you can't build a bonfire at the gates of a hospital or beside houses or beside a filling station, and you can't attack other communities through your bonfires. If it's part of your culture and you want to enjoy it without all the nonsense that goes with it.
As I've already pointed out, if the contentious issues you raised were dealt with, and many of them should be dealt with, may I say, but if they were dealt with next year, you would be on the phone and there'll be something else contentious. Because the ultimate aim is no bonfires.
So your argument
no
is what if?
Unionist culture. No, my argument is what it's always been on your show, is that there's only one ending to this. The ending of this is a total eradication of every aspect of unionist culture.
Stay
that
there, Sean. Stay there. Let's bring in Ricky and Ballyclare as well. Good morning, Ricky.
Morning, Stephen. Well, I'm sorry, but I really need to side with Jamie here. Last night's vote in Mid Ulster, being a nationalist held area, to me, is I'm actually a member of the loyalist organisations, and I'm a unionist. I believe, yes, bonfires shouldn't have tyres or flammable toxic material or anything on them. But at the same time, this is yet another point of Sinn Féin chipping away and chipping away to get a united Ireland. And I, for one, won't stand for it.
Well, this is a licensing scheme for bits of wood. How that contributes to a united Ireland, you'd have to explain that.
Well,
because it's about eradicating British culture. It's about eradicating British culture. The man's right. If you go to the man's club point, what he is actually
saying... It's not eradicating anything if you apply for a license and get it.
Let me make this point, Steve. What the man is saying at its core is correct, because what he's essentially saying is that the nationalist republican narrative and objective is there can never be a settled and well-operating Northern Ireland until the British presence is gone. And with the British presence, that means every aspect and every investigation.
John, let me spell fast, very quickly, John.
Stephen.
Morning, John.
Good morning, Stephen. I'm listening to you about these bonfires. Years ago, we had bonfires in every street corner throughout the province. And the Department of Environment, the DOE Road Division, decided, could we put this stuff on a piece of land so that we're not costing hundreds of thousands of pounds to repair the roads and stop the blocking of traffic? Now, they want us to get a permit to do the... they ask the council, can we put this on your land? If it's the council who decided to give the land in the first place. Now, a point there that the guy from Ballymurphy was on about, he was saying that loyalist areas is this and that is it. Last year or the year before, down in Londonderry, they blocked a four-lane carriageway with a Republican bonfire. And they wouldn't shift it. They left it, they closed the area and went round it till they burnt it, and then they went in.
Listen,
and
no doubt there'll be a lot more to talk about this subject this year as there is most years. Thank you very much to all of you. 03030 80 55 55. With some breaking news this morning, there's a royal visit in Northern Ireland. Prince Harry and his future wife Meghan Markle have just arrived. Sarah Gervin can tell us more about this. Good morning to you, Sarah.
Morning, Stephen.
Good morning. So the stars, the royal stars, have just arrived, have they?
Just arrived in Northern Ireland, Stephen, and they're arguably the most famous couple in the world right now, and they've just landed in Northern Ireland. Now, I'm at the Icon Centre outside Lisburn, jostling with the world press here. It's a very windy, damp day, so not great weather to welcome Prince Harry and Meghan, but they're all here waiting to get that first snap of the engaged couple. Now, Prince Harry was last in Northern Ireland last September, but he was a single man then. This time he's brought his fiancée, American actress Meghan Markle, to meet teenagers here in Lisburn from peacebuilding initiative Amazing the Space. That mission was actually launched by Prince Harry during that visit last September. Now,
lots of school children here, Stephen. They'll be performing musical and theatrical numbers for the couple based on peace building before they move on to their next stop. And as you can imagine, much excitement here. And we are expecting the couple to arrive here in Lisburn within the next few minutes.
Yeah, and Meghan Markle, for those who aren't into their to their box sets and things, like I know Meghan Markle from Suits.
Absolutely. She's a world famous actress, and obviously there, you know, you can't open a magazine or a newspaper at the moment, Stephen, without seeing pictures of her and Prince Harry. Absolute, you know, excitement, that's fever pitch running up to this wedding on May the 19th. So it's a big deal for them to be in Northern Ireland today. And after they leave Lisburn here this morning, it's time for lunch and, well, possibly even a cheeky pint at Belfast. Most famous bar, arguably the Crown. They'll find out about the history of the building there from the National Trust. And if people out there do want to see the couple, well, they will be greeting members of the public on Great Victoria Street. So no doubt many, many hands to shake there. And after the Crown, it's on to Catalyst Inc. It's a science park meeting more young people. So the visit today is very much based on meeting young people and youth leaders. And finally, rounding off that whirlwind trip, they'll be going to Titanic Belfast. From there, it's back on the plane, the visit is over, and back home to Kensington Palace.
And the wedding invites have gone out, Sarah. I haven't got one.
Well, that surprises me, Stephen, but I haven't either. So I'm assuming that ours have been lost in the post. You know, Royal Mail can be slow at this time of year. So the invitations looked amazing when they went out yesterday. But I would say that you'll get squeezed onto the list. I'm certainly free. I have a hat. I'm available. Just putting it out there. I would definitely like to go. But the countdown is really on to May 19th. If you read any sort of newspaper, you know, whether you're familiar with Prince Harry or Meghan Markle, there's so much speculation at the minute about the dress, the big day, the honeymoon, the cake even. We've had lots of news this week about the cake. And that's going to continue for the next few weeks until that wedding day on May the 19th. So a one-day visit to Northern Ireland today, much excitement. But people will be hoping that after the couple get married, they will return to Northern Ireland.
And just finally, there's been no royal weather for today. They're going to get soaked, aren't they?
Well, I'd like to, you know, feel a little bit sorry for them, Stephen, but seeing as I'm already completely drenched to the skin, yeah. I think they'll have more umbrellas and more protection than we will. Just to paint the picture here, we all are hemmed in, waiting for the couple to arrive. There is a bit of a downpour. It has dried off slightly, so maybe that will hold while they arrive, but I would imagine they'll be well protected, not like the press. And as I say, the press really are here from all over the world. Such is the interest in this visit today.
Okay. Sarah Kevin, thank you. So the news this morning that Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, his future wife, they're in town. They've just arrived in Belfast a number of minutes ago. Only in the Nolan Show. I can see some people ringing us here saying they've never heard of Meghan Markle. She's a worldwide superstar actress. Have a look at her in Suits. It's a brilliant show, actually. Right. 03030 80 55 55. Just to reassure you again that we are going through the information that you have given us about clerical sex abuse in Northern Ireland. We've got a team working on that. We hope to bring you future programming around that area. If you do have information, nolan@bbc.co.uk is our email address. Earlier on, someone mentioned that St Coleman School, which of course has been widely discussed regarding clerical sex abuse because of the paedophile Malachy Finnegan who was there. Someone suggested that St Coleman's was under the authority of the CCMS, the Catholic Council, the Catholic Council for Maintained Schools. That is not the case, nor has it ever been the case, and we're happy to clarify that. Right, before we go today, Friday, time to lighten the mood in the last few minutes of our programme. The Dublin comedian and impressionist Al Foran is here with us this morning. Al, good morning to you.
Good morning, Steve.
Good morning.
You?
Sorry you've had to wait today. Busy news day.
Patience is a virtue.
But you see, what you can do then as an impressionist is we can get loads of characters here.
Yeah.
On speed dial.
Absolutely,
can
yeah.
we? Can you do
oh,
that
God,
for
yeah,
us?
Yeah, yeah.
Like Conor McGregor, Donald Trump. Eddie Murphy.
Yeah.
How would they sound if they were welcoming the royals to Northern Ireland?
Well, you know what? First of all, Donald Trump, I'm very upset. I have to say there's no welcoming for me. I'm very happy for Prince Harry and Meghan, but there's no welcoming for me. I arrive in Belfast, and you don't welcome me with open arms. No hugs, nothing. You know, what is it? What is it? Is it a Twitter storm over here that people hate me so much?
You're screwing your face up in the right way as well about Trump.
Well, it's all about the mannerism, Stephen. It really is.
What about Conor McGregor? Do you think he would like the Dolan show?
It's a very good show, I have to say. It was very entertaining hearing that those lads arguing with each other, bickering at each other. Do you know what I mean? I found that very funny, you know? I like this, Stephen.
Is that him laughing? Is that you laughing at your money, Conor?
It is, all 140 million of it. So I'm very happy with that.
Eddie Murphy? My goodness, I remember Eddie Murphy from my childhood.
Mate, you better believe it. I'm going to be here tonight. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be great. The limelight in Belfast. You can still get your tickets at the box office or the ticketmaster.ie. You just go in there. I cannot wait to just entertain the Belfast crowd tonight. It's going to be good.
Mike Tyson.
Man, you know, I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be a really great night. You know, I'm looking forward to you know, pronouncing words for people that they don't know how to pronounce, you know, because my word pronunciation is you know, it's the best pronunciation in the world.
And maybe, Mike Tyson, you can tell us what's actually happening at the Limelight tonight. What time do doors open?
Well, doors open 8 o'clock. You got to be there. You got to be there for 8 o'clock to see this Al Foreign kid. He does a terrible impression of me.
But how do you learn how to do this?
Observe and watch interviews from YouTube. Like, I'm always trying to improve my impressions. Like, one of the new ones is obviously Taoiseach Leo Varadkar.
Yeah, can you? Oh.
Well, obviously, it's fantastic to be here tonight in the Limelight in Belfast. And it was a great visit, obviously, to the White House last week with President Trump, lovely bowl of shamrock. So, very welcoming, have to say. Brilliant.
Can you do me?
I'd have to maybe learn it.
You wouldn't want to do me. I'm not important enough. Who's your favourite character?
It would probably a new character would be the favourite one to do. There's always a new flavour in a month. I suppose Chris Eubank Senior.
Oh, go on. We've got to hear from.
Well, I think that it is very important to speak in such a manner in the way that he does. You know, because the royals obviously are here. Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, and I have watched Suits. Suits is a fantastic show. It really is. Trilling.
Look, there's tickets still available, so if someone wants a night out with you, Al, sorry we haven't had more time to talk to you.
No problem.
But your show's called Impersonate This. As yes. I say, tickets still available, and it's at the Limelight tonight, and the gig starts at 8 o'clock, right?
Yes, absolutely, Steve.
Thanks for coming in this morning.
Thanks for having me, mate.
Good
Cheers.
To talk to you. Right, that's it from us for this week. I'm on 5 Live. I'm flying over to England this afternoon. So I'm on 5 Live tonight at 10 o'clock, Saturday and Sunday night too. Then we'll see you back here on BBC Radio Ulster at 9 o'clock. Thank you so much for supporting us this week. And
it's
Sian's coming up next.
Hey!
See you later. Bye-bye.
Oh, thank you, Stephen. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Sunbeams will soon smile through. Good morning. Good morning to you.
Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Let us sing a song of cheer again. Happy days are here again.
So
since I heard your voice. Believe me, I just had no choice. Wild horses couldn't make me stay away. I thought about a moonlit night, arms around you good and tight. That's all I had to see for me to say. Hey, hey, hello, Mary Lou. Goodbye, heart, sweet Mary Lou.
Ricky Nelson and Hello Mary Lou, starting our little program off this Friday morning. Is it raining here? I think it is. Raining cats and dogs. It is indeed. I hope it's dry.